Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another exciting episode of our new series, Building a Better Future. I'm still here. I'm your host, Malik Evangelados, and I'm still here with Sheikh Kareem Abu Zayd. Please check out Sheikh Kareem online at kareemabuzayd.com, all lowercase, or Islam Way, his YouTube channel, which is IslamWay71 at YouTube. We were talking about in the last episode conditions of empowerment. Why are we not empowered? Before we get into the talk, go grab a mushaf. Every episode that you watch, we want you guys to have your mushaf opened to chapter Noor, verses 46 through 57. The Sheikh has been giving us some outstanding explanations of these verses. You don't want to miss it. So Sheikh, let's continue. We were talking about the conditions of empowerment and why we're not empowered now, because we're not obeying Allah.
Inna alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبد الله ورسوله. Brother Malik, جزاك الله خيرا. Again, this is the third episode covering the most important piece, which the piece has to do with us fulfilling our part of the bargain. You see, Allah made a bargain with us, you know, deal.
He made a deal, promise.
A deal with us, promise with us. وعد الله. If you fulfill your part, I will deliver. Allah will deliver, no question.
No question.
There are a lot of groups, a lot of people who are raising the banner of Islam.
SubhanAllah. Alhamdulillah.
Beautiful.
Beautiful thing.
But we got to question why they are not empowered yet.
Of course.
Because
excellent question.
They are missing something. There is something. There is something wrong that they are missing. The law. That law must be activated, which is we hear and we obey. That's the attitude. And I know you wanted to get into the Battle of Uhud and what happened, because like we compared before, that the Muslims were outnumbered in the Battle of Badr.
You said 3-1, I believe you said.
3-1.
SubhanAllah.
And the conditions out of this world. Yani, in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the night of this battle of Badr, he made dua that is heartbreaking. Heartbreaking. You know what he said? He raised his hand like this and he says, Allahumma innahum jia'un fa'atimhum. Oh Allah, they are hungry. The Muslims.
The Muslims.
The 300
soldiers.
Hungry. You know what they used to eat? A date. They place it in their mouth, and that's their meal for the whole day. And then they suck on it, and they drink water. Allahumma innahum ura faksuhum. They don't have clothes, garments. Garment them. Allahumma innahum ala fahmilhum. They don't walk in their feet. Give them a ride. Oh Allah, if this group of companions is to perish, you're not going to be worshipped in earth. Look at the condition. And Allah mentioned also this in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٍ. Remember Muslims, Allah giving you victory in Badr when you were what? أَذِلَّةٍ.
أَذِلَّةٍ meaning?
دَلِيل.
Oh, small.
Needy.
Oh.
Needing help. Yet, why did they earn that victory?
Because they were obedient.
Obedient to Allah and His Messenger. Let's go into the Battle of Uhud. And why the Battle of Uhud in particular? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed 60 verses about the Battle of Uhud.
SubhanAllah.
In Surah Al Imran, Surah number 3.
Surah number 3,
and
verses.
I can just, وَإِذْ غَدَوْتَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ تُوَوُّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ مَقَاعِدَ لِلْقِتَالِ. I do not recall. Maybe in the break we'll give them the numbers.
Okay, inshallah.
But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed 60 verses about the Battle of Uhud. But first of all, let's just talk about what happened in the Battle of Uhud. And I'm going to take you back to these verses.
Okay.
What happened? Basically, the following year after Badr, the disbelievers were so frustrated, angry, upset, shame that they were defeated.
They were defeated
by
the previous year.
The previous year, 70 of them were killed. A lot of them were imprisoned and so forth. Humiliation.
Ashamed.
To the extent that they went back home, they actually banned themselves from taking showers.
SubhanAllah.
Out of anger. Women were banned to stop wailing, crying.
Oh my goodness. Right.
They returned the following year, a year later, with their women.
To encourage them on the battlefield, to make sure they didn't lose.
Not only this, because you know, when you go and fight in a battle like this,
you don't
really have nothing to fight for. So your chances of fleeing are high.
I see your
but
point.
If you know that your wife,
imagine, of course,
is going to be in prison,
yeah,
then you're going to stand your ground.
You're going to fight to the death.
But yet, they fled too.
In spite of all that.
In spite of all of this. At the very beginning, what happened? Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam held a council, a shura council, with his companions, teaching us the concept of shura, which is taking
council.
Different views and وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَ بَيْنَهُمْ. يعني the story, they decided to go out to the mountain of Uhud. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam looked at the field, the battlefield, and he found a hill. And he placed 50 archers. هذا الحديث في البخاري, حديث البراء ابن عازب رضي الله عنهما. Placed 50 archers on the top of that hill. And he placed an emir, his name is Abdullah ibn Jubayr. And he did say this to them. If you see them following us to Mecca, following us to Medina, meaning that the Muslims are defeated.
And they're fleeing.
And they are fleeing. And the disbelievers are following them to Medina,
right.
Do not leave your post.
Stand on your post.
If you see us following them to Mecca,
meaning that we're winning.
Do not. Crystal clear commands.
No, exactly.
What happened? At the beginning of the battle, the Muslims were saying "Sami'na wa ata'na." They activated the law
of hear and obey.
The law that, you know, would grant them victory. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala said in the Quran, "Walaqad sadaqakumu Allahu wa'dahu." Allah has fulfilled His promise for you, because you fulfilled your part. You were obeying Allah and obeying the Messenger, right?
Right.
Then what happened? They saw that the Muslims were victorious at the beginning of the battle. The disbelievers started fleeing. They left their belongings after them. The archers started thinking about collecting the spoils of war.
Money, wealth.
Wealth. Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anh, and also Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, they were waiting for that mistake.
They had a feeling this was going to happen.
Yes. They were waiting. As soon as those 40 archers, because 10 of them stayed, يعني على صح الأقوال, including their leader, their emir, they refused.
They stayed and were killed.
Yes, yeah. And they died as shuhada, alhamdulillah. But those 40 came down. Khalid bin Walid immediately, as soon as those 40 archers left their post, Khalid bin Walid attacked, radiallahu anhu, before he became a Muslim.
Before,
yes,
obviously.
Attacked the Muslim camp, the Muslim army from the back. The disbelievers who were fleeing
turned around and began to fight them.
Because they learned that Khalid is...
right, so they have them pinched in like a pinch. Pincer movement. Yeah.
Rasulullah was killed, Hamza was killed, Mus'ab ibn Umair was killed. Even some Muslims, the father of Hudayfa ibn al-Yaman, Hudayfa, was killed in this battle at the hands of Muslims.
And Rasulullah, he incurred some injury.
Yeah, well, a rumor that he was killed.
Oh, a rumor that he was killed.
And he got injured.
Yes.
Halaqat al-Maghfar, his
tooth and everything.
Tooth and everything. And mess.
It was a big mess.
Now, why? Why did this happen?
We disobeyed Allah.
They disobeyed Allah and His Messenger.
We lost sight of what's going on.
Yes. Yeah.
We got distracted with money.
Now I want you to take the viewers back to these verses in Surah Al-Imran, Surah number 3. And maybe in the break, inshallah, we'll give them the reference, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in those 60 verses, He talked about riba is haram.
With strong language too.
Yeah. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تأكلوا الربا أضعافا مضاعفة. We believe, do not devour usury. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about suppressing your anger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about sadaqah. A lot of people, once they read these verses, they think they have nothing to do with the battle of Uhud, which is wrong.
Oh, it's so wow.
Actually, they do have relevance.
How does it tie in?
Well,
from obedience.
obedience. You see, if you do not obey the commands at home, you will command it, you will obey it in the battlefield?
Of course not. If you're not obeying it anywhere,
You see, and this is why I don't want the viewers to think that we're talking about battle here and just all. No.
No.
If you do not activate that law at home, when you are at ease, when you are not pressured,
right?
You think you're gonna?
Of course not.
Activate it there under pressure?
Of course not.
No, and that is the relationship between the two. So here is in this battle, which is the battle of Uhud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted this to be a practical example to the ummah that any time that you disobey Allah or the messenger, and the next segment, Malik, we're going to go into this because...
Obeying the messenger.
The messenger, because a lot of people, they say, well, let's just obey Allah and the messenger. We're going to go about this. No, they are together.
Yeah, right.
They are together, Allah and His messenger. And inshallah, I want to stress this after the break.
Inshallah, we will.
After the break, we want to talk about this, obeying Allah and His messenger. And look at the verses that we refer to in Surah An-Nur. قُلْ أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ. Say to them, obey Allah and obey the messenger.
Inshallah, in the next segment, we're going to get into that detail about obeying the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Stay tuned. We're having a wonderful and an interesting conversation with Sheikh Karim Abu Zayd. You don't want to miss it.
Heaven, heaven where I belong. Heaven, heaven where I belong.
Welcome back. Thanks for staying tuned. We're having a wonderful conversation with Sheikh Karim Abu Zayd. We hope you have your Mus'afs open to the third chapter, verses 121 through verses 180. Take a look at those. The Sheikh has given us a wonderful context and explanation to that. And Sheikh Karim, can you continue in that regard?
Well, Malik, before we go there, these verses in Surah Al-Imran, again, I want the viewers to understand why we're asking them to review these verses.
Okay.
Even so, these verses were revealed about the Battle of Uhud and what happened in the Battle of Uhud. But yet you find commands that has nothing to do with the battle.
Like interest. So you think there's no relationship?
No, there is a relationship.
But there is.
Because, you see, if you disobey these commands at home, it impacts the community.
Right.
Imagine a community where there is a portion of it is utilizing and using the rest of it by interest.
Right.
How they will go together in a battlefield and
there's no brotherhood, there's no connection.
There's no brotherhood. It will destroy the brotherhood.
Right, right.
The alternative for this is sadaqah, zakah.
Sadaqah, zakah.
Helping one another.
Yes.
If we bond, bond in the community, then this will lead to our success.
This is our success.
Yes, and this is the relationship. I know you wanted to go into the obedience of Allah and His Messenger, but maybe inshallah the next episode we'll talk about this.
Okay,
but
inshallah.
There is another piece here that I want to, the viewers to be aware of, that a companion, just to let you know how they react, how they used to react to the commands of Allah and His Messenger.
Right, okay, excellent.
A companion would hear a verse.
Right.
A verse, he would come out of his wolf.
Yani, what do you mean, Shaykh?
Well, في عند ابن أبي حاتم سعيد بن جبير طريق ابن عباس السند يعني صحيح
okay.
authentic chain of narration that when this verse was revealed من ذا الذي يقرض الله قرضا حسنا فيضاعفه له أضعافا كثيرة والله يقبض ويبسط وإليه ترجعون a verse in Surah Al-Baqarah whosoever gave Allah a goodly loan
yes
Allah will multiply it for him A companion that a lot of Muslims do not know about. His name is Abu Dihdah. He heard this verse. قَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ He said, O Messenger of Allah, is Allah asking me for a loan?
Misunderstanding of the verse, yeah?
يعني, in a way.
Yeah.
But he knows if Allah asks for a loan, he will give it back
to
him.
I see, yeah. I see.
No. In a way, Allah is asking me for a loan. I want to give Allah a loan.
Showing his obedience, he's ready to obey them.
Yes. Even so, this is something that is not mandatory. It's recommended that you do not have to do. He immediately said, O Messenger of Allah, bear witness that I have given my garden to Allah as a loan. طيب. His garden had 600 palm trees.
Ooh, so he's a wealthy man. This is a lot of money back then and now.
Well, palm trees like stock market now.
Yeah, exactly. I mean,
especially in Medina.
Yeah, right.
He went back home, and he even refused to get into the garden.
He's finished.
He called upon his wife. Ya Umm al-Dahdah, O mother of al-Dahdah, come out. I said, what happened, Ya Abba al-Dahdah? He said, I have given this garden as a loan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bring your children and come out. You know what his wife said to him? Rabiha al-bay'u ya Abba al-Dahdah. What a good bargain that you made.
SubhanAllah. This is a righteous wife. SubhanAllah.
Yeah. You see that? Yeah. How they react to the commands? Right away. How they, طيب, you read this verse في صحيح البخاري. You read this verse. لن تنالوا البر حتى تنفقوا مما تحبون. You will never be able to attain. البر here بمعنى الجنة يعني.
Okay.
يعني you will not reach righteousness and piety. Unless you spend from that which you love most.
This is hard for people to do, for all of us.
But it's very hard, but I want to tell you something. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما في حديث أبي مالك الأشعري في صحيح مسلم وفيه والصدقة برهان. الصدقة is an evidence that you give. Why?
It's a proof, yes.
Why? I'll explain this to you and to the viewers. Why?
Okay.
Because we all fashion to love wealth.
Yes, it's hard not to.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this in the Quran. Is our nafs, our souls are inclined to the love
We're
of wealth.
Attached to accumulating wealth.
Allah said what in Surah Al-Fajr? وَتُحِبُّونَ الْمَالَ حُبًّا جَمَّا جَمَّا. You know that word جَمَّا? You love wealth so much.
So much.
وَإِنَّهُ لِحُبِّ الْخَيْرِ لَشَدِيدٍ. الخير here is wealth.
Right.
And mankind, once it comes to wealth, he loves it dearly.
To accumulate it.
Now, you ask an average Muslim now, do you love Allah or not?
Of course.
He will say what?
Yes, of course.
Okay. You love Allah?
Of course.
Can you give something that you love for someone whom you love?
Shaykh, this is more difficult. But I see your point.
That is why. That is why the Prophet ﷺ said what? وَالصَّدَقَةُ burhan.
Right.
الصَّدَقَةُ is an evidence that you love right. Allah. Because everybody claims that they love Allah.
Right. But when you ask them to make an action.
Okay. Can you give something for the one who? Okay. You love wealth. And this is what Abu Talha al-Ansari, Abu Talha, a companion, when this verse was revealed, you will never be able to attain the highest level of righteousness and piety, which is al-birr, which is Jannah, unless you spend from that which you love most.
That's the meaning. You're right.
You will never be able to attain the love of Allah unless
you spend from what you love.
You spend from what you love because you're giving it to someone whom you love most.
And it shows your obedience. It's signing to obedience.
And it shows you, yes, yeah. Absolutely. Look, Abu Talha, I want hearing this verse. Okay. You want to say, I hear and I obey. Immediately, you know what he said? Ya Rasul Allah, O Messenger of Allah, Inna ahabba mali ilayya bi'ru bayruha. The most beloved wealth to me, O Messenger of Allah, is that garden called Bayruha. Rasulullah used to go and drink from its well. Sufficient that the Messenger comes and drinks from its well. Ya Rasul Allah, I want to give it to Allah.
That's what he loved most.
Yes.
And he was willing to give it. Showing
again,
obedience.
Again, Rasulullah, look at the obedience. Look at the
reaction.
Yeah, Rasulullah loves us. An-Nabiyyu awla bil-mu'mineena min anfusihim. Rasulullah loves us more than we loving ourselves. Rasulullah told Abu Talha al-Ansari, the husband of Umm Sulaym, the mother of Anas, Ya Abu Talha, give it to your kins, your family. Distribute it amongst your family.
SubhanAllah.
Yeah, so this is what got the companions going.
This is what they got them going.
You hear right now, you see a lot of Muslims wearing gold, Malik.
We see this,
men.
Yes.
Men.
Right.
Wearing gold.
We know this is forbidden.
Haram.
Can't understand why they would
haram. في السنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says, Allah has banned the men of my ummah from wearing gold.
This goes to obeying the messenger
طيب.
As well.
Look, yeah, نعم. نعم it relates to obeying the messenger. Now look at this now. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم at one stage والحديث الصحيح he saw a companion wearing a golden ring
and he threw it down.
He said take it out and he threw it in the ground. After the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم left, after he left, Huh? And then the companion said, take
your, pick it up.
Pick it up.
Sell it, make money.
Sell it, make money, give it sadaqah. Ma kunt. I'm not to pick up something that the Prophet threw.
That's how far the people want to be from sadaqah. In those days.
Look at it. You know, I come, you know, Jum'ah is a place where a lot of people who are not really regular in the masjid, they come and pray.
And you see them on Jum'ah.
And then I see them wearing gold. And then I go to the brother, yani, wearing gold is haram for the ummah.
Right.
So yeah, let me think about it. The messenger said, let me think about it. But I want to tell you also that there are people I have witnessed with my own eyes. Some brothers whom you tell them this, they take it out.
Immediately.
Said, Sheikh, give it sadaqah.
This is true faith. Subhanallah.
Again, activating the law of kumma. Because you need to understand this. If you want, because an-nasru min indillah, victory comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, if you want Allah to help you, you must obey Allah.
Right, right.
You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you victory without all this. All what you have to do is just seek the means that is within your capacity.
Seek the means that are within our capacity.
That's
right.
It.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
But your capital, your asset, right, is the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger.
Sometimes it seems, Shaykh, if we're obedient to Allah, it seems like we're going to lose out. Like, for example, if I give $100 in charity, I feel like, well, I just lost $100. But if I give $100 to the bank, oh, I'm going to gain $10 in interest. So even when it seems like it's not going to benefit us, we have to have faith that Allah is going to empower us if we're obedient, right?
يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى وَيُرْبِي الصَّدَقَاتِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause your usury to diminish. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless your sadaqah.
So we have to go against our nafs and believe in Allah. That's the point.
You see, a lot of these commands, they go against your nafs. And that is why we have to strive against our nafs in order to be able to fulfill the law of sami'na wa ata'na. And again, Malik, we must obey Allah and His Messenger. And I know we want to get into the rest of the series, but I think it is important that we take a whole episode
for this
explaining
topic,
that the obedience of Allah and His Messenger together
go hand in hand.
Because right now we have in the Ummah a group called the Qur'ani.
And what are they saying?
Qur'ani say that we follow the Qur'an only.
With no hadith.
Hadith da'if. We go like, Mish'arif, Allah only preserve the Qur'an and all this sci-fi stuff.
So we definitely talk about this.
That's why we're behind.
Right.
That's why we're behind. That is why we're not empowered in earth. We want the viewers to realize that the only way for us to come back and to take the lead again, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained for us to do.
And commanded us.
We have to obey Allah and obey the Messenger.
Full stop, period. No questions.
No question. No. And inshallah, we're next episode, inshallah, I know the time is running out. We can get into this, inshallah.
Okay.
The obedience of the Messenger is tied to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Jazakallah khairan. Thank you very much for your time, Shaykh. Another wonderful conversation. And once again, to the viewers, stay tuned. You don't want to miss our next episode of Building a Better Future. We have Shaykh Kareem Abu Zayd all the way here from Denver, Colorado. In the meantime, study those verses that we talked about and check out Shaykh Kareem online at kareemabuzayd.com. Until next time, we leave you in the care of Allah. Assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
اللهم اجعلني من